cheering. One quick thing, I'm going to step down. I'm going to give it over to the children and the youth. The youth song is going to be a little different this morning. I know a lot of people think every youth song is different, and it is, I guess. But I hope more than anything you're listening to the words of it, as today it talks about giving yourself away. So I hope you enjoy these young people. This is the church of tomorrow, and this is where we're doing such a great job. We just need to invite some friends, right? All right. You can stand and join in.
Forever mine. myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Take my heart and take my myself away so you can use me. I give myself away.
Oh, to you.
I give myself away so you can use me. My life is not my own. To you myself, I give myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you.
Oh, we give ourselves to you, God.
To
Thank you. You may be seated. We didn't quite reach the 100 mark, but we had 92 in Sunday school. It's a good number for getting back into the our normal fall schedule. We have now our birthdays and anniversaries. I forgot about that. So, while we were standing, we were supposed to be calling everybody to come forward. So, I'm calling now. Anybody who has a birthday and or wedding anniversary to celebrate?
All right, look at all these August birthdays and anniversaries. Now listen, if you have an anniversary or birthday, come on, this is the one chance you get to be embarrassed in front of the whole church for the year. Come on. What a good-looking group. Oh. All right, Brother Heinrich, this is a Baptist church. You can't do that here. I'm just kidding. What a good-looking crowd. Gracious alive. We're going to start with birthdays. I know we have one birthday who's a guest back there from Augusta. Raise your hand. Tell us your name again. Angie, when is your birthday? Today is her birthday. Happy birthday, Angie. So glad to have you with us. All right, whose birthday is here? Birthday girl, come on.
Oh, August 18th.
August 18th. You going to have a happy birthday this year?
Oh, yes.
Make every one of your family take you out to eat at least twice and pay for it, right?
Oh, yeah, and David always likes to take me and get the senior citizen discount.
Oh, she threw you under the bus, David. All right, happy birthday. How about you, birthday girl?
August 5th.
August the 5th. Did Michael take you out for a good birthday?
We did. Last night.
Too, right?
Yes.
Oh, awesome, awesome. Anniversary? Birthday, all right.
August 18th. We'll probably be looking for the senior citizen discount, too.
Hey, tell them not to knock that senior citizen discount. It's good, right? Happy birthday, Miss Barbara. All right, birthday boy?
Birthday, 44 on August 23rd.
44 on August 23rd. I like an honest man, don't y'all? Love it. Congratulations, Brother Tripp. Happy birthday. Birthdays?
August 14th.
August 14th. How about the girls, too?
August the what?
August the 16th. And another birthday girl in the family?
August 26th.
Hey, look at this. All Tony, you are a proud man. All the beautiful ones in your family got birthdays. Happy birthday, everybody. Thank you so much. They're like, we ain't talking to him. Okay, all right.
August 9th.
August 9th. Happy birthday. You going to get like a week off from school with pay?
I don't think so.
Okay, all right. All right, birthday boy?
August 31st.
August the 31st. How old?
15.
15. To be 15 again, right? And to know what we know now. Happy birthday. All right, Maddie-Kate.
August 31st.
August 31st also?
I'll be 15.
So. You'll be 15 too? Wow, wonderful. Congratulations. Bless you. Yes. All right, birthday boy?
Oh, it's hers. August 18th, she'll be 1 year old.
Oh, Lucy, 1 year old. Look at. Let me get out of the way where everybody can take a good look at this beautiful young lady. 1 year old. Happy birthday. What do you think, Lucy? She says, Ryan, I've never seen anything that weird looking. Okay, we're moving on. Birthday boy. How old will you be, young man?
I turned 38 on August 3rd.
38 on August the 3rd. Happy birthday. I got jokes, but I'm just going to move on and leave them. So, all right, birthday boy, happy birthday.
August 18th.
How old will you be?
15.
15, love it. Man, that is great. Birthdays, all right. Birthday?
August 29th, and I'll be 10.
August 29th, 10 years old. Yay, way to go, Sam Wyatt. We were loving watching you guys sing up there a while ago. Y'all did a great job. Happy birthday. All right, anniversary and birthday, okay.
I was 31 yesterday.
31 yesterday. Happy birthday. Love it. How about you, Tommy? August also?
No, anniversary.
Anniversary? Birthday?
August 25th.
And how does it feel to be another year older and better looking?
Tired sometimes.
Tired sometimes. Amen. Truth well spoken. Birthday also?
Birthday August 1st, 61.
Oh, wow. Wow, congratulations. Happy birthday. Okay, birthday girl.
Well, we both have the same birthday. It just happened that way. But between the five of the family, we have 301 years altogether, and all of us qualify for the senior bus trip free, except for one.
Love it. love it. Happy birthday. Now, what date is it?
8th.
August the 8th. And yours is it? Now, who's older?
She's the oldest. Can't you look and tell?
Oh!
Only by 1 minute.
1 minute older. Man, I tell you what. You two are so beautiful, but after I have eye surgery, y'all mess with me when I'm looking up from the pulpit because I'm thinking I'm seeing double again. Bless you. Y'all are so beautiful. All right, birthday boy.
August 7th. Good day.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. What about Luke? Does he have one this month? Okay. Krista?
August 6th, yesterday.
Happy birthday. Love it. Congratulations. Today. Happy. Man, we got a bunch of today birthdays. Happy birthday. Are the boys going to take you out?
They were in the kitchen an early a.m. making a three-layer cake for me.
Sean can cook some mean pancakes. We found that out.
Yes, indeed.
Happy birthday. All right, birthday girl.
August 27th, and I'll be 51.
51? Wow, congratulations. Hubby's going to take it. That's right, just a young child. Anniversary? Birthday, okay.
I am having, on August the 6th, I've already had it, right? But I'm having my last 70th birthday in the 70s.
Hey, wow, congratulations. Let's give her a hand. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Birthday? Anniversary. All right. All right, y'all ready? Anybody else did we miss? Any other birthdays? Yeah, we got Hammer. That's okay. All right, let's sing. Here we go. Happy birthday. Let's give them a big hand. We love you guys. Happy birthday. Thank you so much for letting us celebrate your birthday. We hope you have a wonderful birthday. Okay, anniversaries. I'm going to turn the mic over to Brother David now.
Come on down. You'll soon see why I'm doing this part. anniversary, then.
August 1st.
August 1st. It's already been, and how many years?
35.
Great. 35. Congratulations. Congratulations. Anniversary, too.
August 18th.
Okay. How many years?
54.
54. Wow. You may take home the cake today. We have another anniversary today, and it is today.
Today? Right? 6 years.
6 years. Any comment?
I am happier today than I was 6 years ago.
Amen. Now that's great. Congratulations.
Pray for her.
Yeah. What's the date?
August 3rd.
August 3rd. Sorry, Ben. Then how many years?
9 years.
Yay. Congratulations. Congratulations. We have a younger couple.
August 2nd.
August 2nd, and you had how many years?
Two.
2 years of wedding bliss. Congratulations. I imagine it's more than 2 years for you all.
I believe so.
But what's the date?
August 23rd.
August 23rd. How many years?
19.
How about that? Congratulations. And I imagine it's more than two for you all. But what's the date?
August the 23rd. 69, I think that was 1969.
Oh, okay.
67.
47 years. Let's congratulate them. And let's sing happy anniversary to them. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. God bless you. Happy God bless you all. God bless you. All right, I think it's women's ministry time. Oh, and here she is.
Good morning. As you can probably imagine, I was persuaded to be up here by someone who is very persuasive in my family. But anyway, I know school is starting tomorrow, and I would like to talk a little bit today using the women's moment to talk to young women. I'd like to talk today about beauty, because it's something as a young woman and as a girl that, you know, is we're pressured a lot about. So women are influenced from our society to look a certain way and to be attractive while we are raising children or gaining education, cooking dinner, making history, managing our own businesses, volunteering, and basically just handling business. The pressures that we face as young women and older women, which begin when we are young girls, it intensifies as we grow to meet these societal needs and standards of beauty, and it can be very overwhelming. But thankfully, as Christian women, we are able to find refuge from these pressures. Psalms 139:14 reminds us, ladies, that you are beautifully and fearfully made. God made each of us with beauty in mind. He made no mistakes. He made no blunders. And he looks at each one of us with admiration of his beautiful creation. Again in Psalms 45:11, the Bible reads that the king is enthralled with your beauty. Honor him, for he is your king. Imagine that the God of all things, all people, who created our world and its numerous magnificent sights, is enthralled with your beauty. He sees the beauty in all of us, and it captivates him. And sometimes as young women, growing women, maturing young ladies, even knowing that that beauty that we hold comes from God, it can still be very difficult to handle all these pressures. And it is for those times that God gives us 1 Peter 3:4 that says, your beauty should be that of your inner self, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of great worth in God's sight. God provides us with everything that we need to flourish as a Christian woman in this modern world. Facing the pressures of an image is just one of a multitude of obstacles that the contemporary Christian woman battles. Be it falling faith, waning hope, or self-doubt, God provides us with all that we need to thrive in him. Because remember, like Psalm 46:5 states, God is within her, and she will not fall.
It's good to have people that are influential in family life, aren't they? It's good to have the choir back, and they will be singing Leaning on the Everlasting Arm.
Thank you.
I was approached early this week and said, the sermon this week is going to be on time. Well, I thought she meant it wasn't going to be late. But no, the subject is on time. And so we have decorations that carry through with that theme. I asked if they were all set to go off at noon in case Jerry goes a little long, but I was assured there are no batteries in any of these clocks, so you don't have anything to worry about. We've also had some suggestions about some timely hymns that at least include the word time in them. So we're going to start through this medley. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Have you thought about where time fits in there? Let's sing.
Thank you.
Dear Father God, thank you, Lord, so much for this day, for the blessings that you've given us. Father, thank you for giving us time that we can grow and learn about you, that we can come and worship you. And Father, thank you for the knowledge that the time will come when we will spend eternity with you. You blessed us in so many ways. Thank you for being our God and allowing us to be a part of the workings of your kingdom through your tithes and offerings. And we ask now that you bless them in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ms. Gay. Brothers and sisters, if you have your Bibles, we're going to be in Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, we're going to be reading from verses 36 to 46. Matthew 26, beginning with verse 36. Now, I got to tease Ms. Gladys Strickland a little bit. If you look in the windows of the church, you'll see every window has a clock. And when she was talking about this sermon this week, I was teasing Ms. Gladys. I said, Ms. Gladys, are you trying to give me a hint? You know, that set every clock to 12 o'clock. But Miss Gladys, I want you to know Brother David and Miss Gay are way ahead of you. Y'all never see behind the pulpit. This is the present that I was given a while back so that I would close to get out on time. So I don't know where the pick came from. I'm not supposed to do it with that. But so we're going to be on time today. We're going to be on God's time. Brothers and sisters, let me ask you something. If you've seen, does anybody ever watch the commercials for Dish or DirecTV? You see them all the time. It don't matter what cable system you have, they're going to come in with those Dish Network or those DirecTV ads or Xfinity or whatever the one is. Do you realize that they all basically have the same channels, right? We all understand that, right? Every cable company has basically the same stuff. So they can't sell you on extra channels that nobody else has, maybe a couple. What they try to sell you on is all these cool features that they have. Like Dish Network right now is the Hopper. You can record 16 programs at once. Anybody seen this ad? Where like 16 shows at once, you won't have to ever miss an episode of Alaskan Bush People ever
if you get Dish. You can record House Hunters, House Hunters International, House Hunters Renovation International. You know, Mexico, all that stuff we watch at home, Mexico Life, Caribbean Life, all that kind of stuff where we watch other people spend money that we don't have, right? You can do that. DirecTV, they try to get you another way. They've got this new thing now. I think it's John Bon Jovi singing. Anybody seen this commercial where John Bon Jovi says you can rewind time for 48 hours? You know, in other words, if you think 2 days ago I might have missed something, I can rewind back and I can watch a show from 48 hours ago. Don't you wish we could do real life right that? Does anybody want to go back in time a little bit? I would like to go back in time to when I had hair. I would like to go back to that time. Unfortunately, we can't. We are here today at this moment. What has happened before is gone. What will happen tomorrow has not yet come. So we're going to talk about this, how important it is for Christians to make the most out of every single day, every single moment we have, because you know what? Make the most of today, because today is going to be history in just a little while. Let me show you a slide real quick before we read our scripture. This is such a classic passage of scripture, but we're going to look at it from a little different light. I want you to imagine this. This is probably where Jesus spent his last hours before he was arrested. In this general area, this picture was taken from the Mount of Olives, where Jesus took the disciples to pray at the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, it would have been nighttime, but this is what, can you imagine? This is Jesus. Now, I want you to imagine before we read this passage. Jesus is there. He is praying, Lord, please let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but yours be done. He's watching the Roman soldiers come down from the city of Jerusalem. They would have had to come down to the Kidron Valley, which we're looking at right in front of us. They would come down that hill there, and they would have come up and arrested him. He is watching this as he's praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, that kind of sets us up. That's what's happening. He can see the people coming to arrest him as he's praying to the Lord. Now we're going to pick up and read, starting with verse 36 of Matthew 26. Then Jesus came with them, the disciples, to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to the disciples, sit here while I go and pray over there. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. Of course, that would be James and John. And he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Now listen to this next sentence. Look at this. Stay here and watch with me. He's asking them for a favor. He went a little farther and he fell on his face and he prayed again, saying, oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God, I know what's coming. I don't want to go through it. Lord, if there's any way, let this go. Let me not have to do this. But then he says, nevertheless, no, Father, not my will, but yours be done. Then he came to the disciples and he found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Again, he's talking about what's going on in his heart. Jesus was fully God, but he was also fully human, just like every one of us. He was not looking forward to what was going to happen to him in the next 24 hours. He was greatly troubled, the human side of him. Again, a second time, he went away and he prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. So he left them. He went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. He's been watching them come down the hill with their torches at night. Now they're here. And he finishes verse 46, rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer, Judas, is at hand. Wow, incredible passage of Scripture. Let's pray together. Father, Lord, this is a night like no other night in the history of humankind. This is the night where you gave, the Lord Jesus Christ gave everything for us. Father, in spite of all the stuff he was going through, he stood up and he faced that hour of suffering that came upon him. Lord, Jesus suffered this night and the next day so that we could be forgiven of our sins. We could be free. We could come to Jesus and say, Lord, save me. Lord, forgive me. Lord, cleanse me from my sins. Father, Jesus Christ made the most of the time he had. Help us to do the same. Father, this morning we're talking about time. Lord, help us not see time as our enemy, but time as a gift from you. Lord, have your will and your way in this service. I pray that before this service is done today, every person in here, before they walk out of this church, they will know, I know that I'm saved. I know that I'm going to heaven. I know that my sins have been forgiven. And I know that I'm walking with Jesus to the very best of my ability now that I am saved. Help us to not just hear about your will, but help us, Lord, to take that next step and do your will and make the most of the time we have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, just to set this passage up, for the last few hours of his life, Jesus started talking plain. Anybody ever read those parables in the New Testament, the words in red, you know, and you don't understand it all, and you knew the disciples, when Jesus said it to them, they didn't understand everything? Of course they didn't. He was teaching them while he was doing God's will, but now, for the last few hours, he's been speaking very plainly to them. He's been saying to them, listen, I am going to be betrayed, and one of you is going to do it. And they're all like, what? Who is it? It can't be me. It can't be me. Well, he's telling them this, but they still don't get it. Anybody besides me? I think I get the award sometimes for don't get it. Do y'all get the award? You know, when something's happening, and at the time, you just don't understand what's going on, but later you see, you know, I wish I'd have gotten it at the time. The disciples still don't get it. So they go to the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus is in the most hour of anguish that he's been in his young life, and they fall asleep. The disciples did not understand how important what was about to happen to them was going on. They had not ever grasped yet the concept of making the most out of time. They completely wasted. Can you imagine in years after this, once Jesus died, once Jesus rose again, and once Jesus left and went back into heaven, don't you think the disciples thought this? I wish I'd have understood that night what was going on, because I'd have stayed awake. And I'd have spent those last few hours encouraging Jesus, helping Jesus, but now I've missed it and I can never have it again. Time moves on. Brothers and sisters, I've got 3 points for you about time. This is so important to every single one of us. It's just as important to me as it is to you. First slide, Brother Frank's going to put on the screen. We have a limited amount of time to be born again and then to accomplish our life's purpose. Do you realize the most important thing you need to make time for is to get saved while you still have breath in your body? Amen? That is the most important thing that's ever happened in any of our lives. It is not so important that you have a college education. It's nice. It's not so important that you have a nice house to live in as it is to make sure before you die that you're born again. That's important. Because what do you do there is going to affect you for all the rest of eternity. No, you know, I feel so bad every time one of those Muslim terrorists stabs somebody or drives a truck down the road and runs over a bunch of people and gets killed by the police or blows himself up with a suicide vest. Because do you realize not only have they taken other lives, but they have sacrificed themselves to an eternity in hell? Think about that. We're doing the same thing, though. If you're here this morning and you're not a child of God through Jesus Christ, you are condemning yourself to an eternity in hell. That's hard, but it's the truth. That is the truth. You have a limited amount of time on this planet to figure out that Jesus is the Messiah, Jesus is the Son of God, Jesus did die for me, and I have a chance to be saved only through Jesus Christ. And then after that, what does Jesus want me to do? That's our mission in life. That's every human being's mission. I just grieve for those people who reject Jesus. I remember, I've told the story many times, but I remember going with Tim Rowell. Oh my gosh, this broke my heart. Tim Rowell, I was his associate pastor when he was at Hoboken Baptist. Somebody called and said, there's a man about to pass away at Brunswick Hospital. Will y'all come? So Tim says, come on, you want to go with me? And I said, sure. And we walked in, and literally the man, y'all, is breaths away from dying. He is literally gasping for his last few breaths. And Tim tried to talk to him. He had found out he was a baseball fan. So Tim tried to talk to him. He said, you know, listen, you're wrong. You've gone around third plate, and you're about to make it home right now. But you don't want to cross home plate without Jesus Christ. He's saying to the guy, you know, you're dying in just a few minutes here, and you don't want to go into eternity without Jesus. And the man says, I don't want that. Leave me alone. Between gasps, go away and don't bother me. It broke our heart. We left that hospital. 5 minutes later, that man died. 5 minutes. God sent him two preachers 5 minutes before he died. That's how much God loved him. He wanted to give him one last chance to repent. You know what? This may be your last chance this morning to repent of sin and have Jesus as your personal Savior. You realize that? Yesterday, I went to the funeral. Did anybody hear about Miles Brooks? Miles Brooks was a 2004 graduate of Brantley County High School. He just had his 30th birthday. I went to his funeral, Marcia and I did, yesterday. 30 years old, had a heart attack and died. I don't think Miles got up that morning thinking, I'm going to die today. But it's all going to happen. Do you realize the moment we're born, the clock starts ticking down, not up? Tick, 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 tick. Time is not our enemy. Do you realize time is a blessing from God if we take advantage of our time that we have left? You know, I love it. I love to go to the ball game. Brother Tripp, don't you love when the clock is counting down right at the end of the game and you're 20 points ahead? Don't you love it? What are you doing, Brother Tripp, that last 2 minutes when you're 20 points ahead and the other team can't even dribble? What are you doing? Woohoo! What is the other team doing, though? It's 2 minutes left and they're down by 20 points. What are they doing? They're panicking because they are losing. Brothers and sisters, God, if you're saved, dying is not a bad thing, right? Dying means I'm counting down to go be with Jesus. So we look at it all the wrong way. God wants to bless our time. Every one of us, he wants us to not know how much we have, but he wants us to make the most of it. The Christian life is a countdown to victory, not a countdown to tragedy. I love it. You know, it's not how many years we have down here. It's what we did with them that's really important. Jesus would tell us today, just like he would have told the disciples, make the most of today. Make the most of every minute. Make the most of every second. Make whatever you're going to do for God, do it now while you have time. Don't forget about yesterday. Don't worry about tomorrow. Live today. Miss Gladys had a great idea. Students, I want to give you some advice. You're going back to school, brand new school year. This is the best advice anybody give you next to being saved. That's the best advice anybody ever give you. Be saved. Number two, don't do like me. Stop being a test taker and become a lifelong learner. Amen, older adults? Stop being a test taker. I was a test taker. I admit it. I didn't know at the time that I was a test taker. All I lived for was to pass the next test. If I can just get through this test, I can cruise through this class, and then I can get on to what's really important, recess, lunch. I was good at lunch and recess. I excelled at those two. You know, I can get to that. You have the best school system in the entire world if you go to school in Brantley County, Georgia. Do you realize that, kids? You have the most godly people I've ever met in the entire world. You have some of the best teachers, some of the best administrators. It doesn't get any better than Brantley County school system in this world. And the tests are proving it now. Our scores are through the roof and all. It doesn't get any better. Make the most of it. Don't waste your time. Don't look back and regret later. Students, can I tell you something? We don't like to let this secret out. Nobody will care once you graduate whether you were cool at school or not. When you get out into the world, nobody will care. If you are class president or like me, class reject, nobody will care. You get to start over when you graduate. Stop worrying about what all the other kids think and worry about what Jesus thinks. As a student, live for Jesus at school. Be a Christian student. Do the very best you can. Soak up and learn everything you can. I should have paid attention in geometry class. I realize that now. I can't even not only do any angles or anything. I try to build something, help my dad build, and it fell in. Because we can't even do a left or a right angle. I'll never be a carpenter now. I could have paid attention in geometry class and at least figured out how to use some of that stuff, the level and all that stuff. Make school an exciting opportunity. Adults. You know, some of us adults have a few knocks along the way. Raise your hand, adults, if you've had a few knocks. The school of hard knocks. Boy, that hurts on the knees, don't it? You know what? Some of us blow it. All of us blow it, actually. But then we spend the rest of our lives looking back and regretting what happened yesterday. You know, you don't know what I've been through. Oh, my gosh, blah, blah, blah. You know, and I've been on that pity party, too. No, if anybody knew what I've had to endure, they'd just feel so sorry for me. God says, put the past in the past. Forget what happened. You were not raised in the perfect family, neither was I. You did not have the perfect upbringing. There is no perfect family except the family of God that's going to be in heaven. And let's move forward and look forward. By the way, parents, if you have children, thank God you do. A lot of people would love to have kids. You know, Christians in church, don't we do this too? Instead of redeeming the time God has given us to build God's kingdom, we're always trying to give somebody else in the church a makeover. Well, if I tweak you a little bit, you'll be good. You know, if we tweak this at the church, you know, the church is not quite right because it's not what I want. So when I tweak that to what I want, then that'll be God's will, right? You know, let's just make the church over. Let's make some of the other people in the church over rather than just loving them and saying, God bless you. I can't wait to see you. You realize it's going to be 20, 30 before we turn around? I remember thinking in the year 2000, I would be 40 years old. And I remember thinking, will I be able to get around at 40 in the year 2000? Anybody remember that? Thinking the year 2000, how old I'm going to be? 2030 is going to be here like that. We need to make the most of the time. You know what? Let me just say this again. Let me reiterate this. If you need to get saved this morning, now is a good time. If you need to get right with Jesus Christ, there will never be another better time than this. Christians, if you're saved and you need to come back to Jesus, there will never be a better time. I love it. We have a limited time to be born again and then to accomplish our life purpose. Won't you hate to be laying in Bayview thinking, I wish I could go back and do some things different? Won't anybody hate that? Won't you be living with that guilt when you're in the nursing home or you're at home about to pass away and thinking, oh my gosh, I've messed up my whole life. I could have got right with God. I could have loved my family more. I could have been a good Christian. I could have been a better this or better that. Now's the time to fix all that. Okay, number two. How do we do that? You know, it's good to talk about, I want to make the most of my time. Number two, how do you do it? Brother Frank's going to put this on the screen. The only real way to redeem the time we have fully is to give Jesus Christ control of my daily schedule, my daily life. Anybody use their GPS on their phone besides me? You know, I love the GPS because you put in, I'm here and I want to go there. And that little lady comes on. She is so sweet. She tells me, she says, She says, the fastest way to get from Nahana to Brunswick is to use US 82. She says, and you can be there in 27 minutes. And I go, well, thank you, ma'am. That's so sweet of you, right? The fastest way. What is the fastest way to have my life start to mean something and work out and really be a blessing to me and to be happy? The fastest way is to give Jesus control of my daily schedule. Let me tell you how easy it is. You know how easy it is to give Jesus control of your daily schedule? You do like this every morning. Lord Jesus, here I am. Use me today for your will. Amen. That's it. That's all you got to do and mean it. Do that every day. And guess what happens in about a month or 2 months or 3 months? All of a sudden, all these things start making sense. Kind of like tithing. You know, this is not a sermon on tithing. But I was amazed before I started tithing as a Christian, I never had any money. And now that I started tithing, somehow my math does not add up to how God continues to bless me. In other words, I'm like, there's no way I'm supposed to be able to pay my bills and, you know, sometimes I wouldn't have anything left, but I started tithing. There was money left over, and I couldn't figure out, well, that was God. How did you do that? I don't know, but he did it. What's going to be important at the end of your life? Is there going to be a Georgia, I'm a Bulldog fan. Is there going to be a Georgia Bulldog Club in heaven? Yeah, somebody said yeah. Okay. Dream on. Okay, there will not be a prize in heaven for making the most home Georgia games. I'm sorry. I hate to bust y'all's bubble, and mine too. There will not be a prize. Will there be a prize in heaven for knowing the best fishing holes on the Satilla River? You know, oh man, will there be a prize in heaven for being able to read a deer track and tell that the deer came by 37 minutes and 14 seconds ago? Will there be a prize for shopping and blowing your credit cards through the roof? What will there be rewards for in heaven? You see, if Jesus is redeeming our time, we start to realize what's really important in life. Will there be a reward for praying more? Oh, yeah. Will there be a reward for loving my neighbor as myself? Oh, yeah. Will there be a reward for being faithful to my church when I can't stand it? What's going on down there? Oh, yes. Will there be a reward for sacrificing some of my free time for God's kingdom? Absolutely. Brothers and sisters, that's important. You know, if we put God first, he'll clear out the clutter. So many things that we think are important. It's so funny. I'll get to watching TV. Now, I do this. Husbands, I'm not the only one guilty of this. I'm going to confess right here in front of my wife and everybody. I'll get to watching TV, and I get so intense watching Pawn Stars. Marsha will come in the room and talk to me, and I go, hush, I'm watching TV. You ever done that, fellas? You know, that's not a wise way to live, by the way. I just want to tell you that. So, see what happened? My priorities are messed up. I get to thinking this TV show is so important. Does a TV show compare to my wife? No. And God has to tell me, now, wait a minute, buddy. You need to go turn the TV off and go see what's going on with your wife. Everything like that. Lord, I give you my day. This guy needed to change his priorities. I love this joke. There's a group of friends went deer hunting, and they paired off for the day in twos. That night, one of them came back alone, and he's staggering under an 8-pound buck. Fellas, right? Let that happen to me, right? He's toting an 8-pound buck on, or 8-point buck, sorry. 8-pound buck. I don't think that one's... Now you know why I shouldn't go hunting. I just ruined my chances of anybody inviting me deer hunting this year. Anyways, he was toting an 8-point buck on his back. And the other guy said, where's Harry? He went with you. He goes, Harry had a stroke or something. He's back on the trail. And they said, you left Harry laying there and brought the deer back? He said, well, I figured nobody was going to steal Harry. Priorities. Finally this morning, number three, the third point. It's time to graduate to the next level with Jesus Christ. That's what he really wants from us this morning. Wherever we're at, he wants us to come up higher to the next level. Think about the disciples. Now, y'all want y'all to think about the disciples. The disciples were students of Jesus. They had been walking with Jesus for 3 years. They had been used to Jesus telling them everything to do, and then they went and did it, right? Jesus spoon-fed them for 3 years. What they didn't realize was Jesus is about to leave, and he's putting them completely in charge of Christianity. Do you realize that? Jesus, after he was crucified, 50 days later, he sent the Holy Spirit. Then he went back into heaven and left them completely in charge with everything. Now, go do my will. You see what? They weren't ready. They were not ready, but time was moving on. Let me say something. Somehow we've gotten this idea in the church, and I know it's from the world. See, in the world out there, you'd have to have a certificate. To be a teacher now, the teachers have to take more tests than the students do. They have to be certified and all this kind of stuff, and some of that is good, but we think that applies to the church. You know, well, you can't serve God unless you have a degree from the seminary, or you can't serve God unless you've been trained by EE Explosion, or M this, or F that, or whatever, you know, You know what I'm saying? You have to have all these certain. What do we really need to serve Jesus Christ? A heart. You don't have to know everything in the Bible. You don't have to understand everything in the Bible. All you got to do is say, Lord, here I am. Use me. Lord, here I am. Send me. In other words, don't let that come into here. God doesn't want a bunch of experts. He wants a bunch of hearts who are willing to serve him and ready to go. He'll train us as he sends us, right? He will take care of us. It's time to graduate to the next level with Jesus this morning and say, Lord, here I am. Father, what do you want? Lord, I want to be saved. Lord, I want to be baptized. Lord, I want to serve you. Lord, I want to do anything. Whatever your will is. Johann Sebastian Bach, listen at this. This is deep. This is what he said. He said, it's easy to play any musical instrument. All you have to do is touch the right key at the right time, and the instrument will play itself. Is that deep? I made this up to go along with it. It's easy to be a victorious Christian. All you have to do is reach out and grab a hold of Jesus with everything you got right now. That's it. It's easy to be a victorious Christian. All you have to do is say, Lord, I don't know. Forget about the past. Forget about tomorrow. Right now, I'm walking with you. Lord, right now, I'm going to be saved. Right now, I'm going to follow you. While I have the time to do it. That time is now. Just like everything else must come to an end, this service is about to come to an end. What are you going to do? What, from this moment forward with the rest of your life, where are you and Jesus going? That's the only question that's important this morning. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. Lord, thank you that you have given us time to be saved. Father, thank you that you have given us everything we need to be born again, everything we need to follow you, everything we need to be victorious. You have given us the tools when you created the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Lord, the question is, what are we going to do? Are we going to take advantage of this opportunity? Are we going to take advantage of the free opportunity to be saved for all eternity, to have our sins forgiven right now this morning, and to walk out of here a changed person? Are we going to take advantage of that? Lord, are we going to take advantage of the opportunity to serve you if we are saved? Are we going to keep putting you on the back burner like we've done? Well, I'll get to you, Jesus, when I have a little more time. Only problem is, Lord, our time may be running out and we don't know it. Some of us might not be here next Sunday. We might be down at the funeral home. Help us to make the boast of the time you've given us. Lord, help us to realize now is what I have. Now is when I need to get serious with God. Because tomorrow is coming, whether we like it or not. We're not always going to be together in this church. Next year, this time, none of us could be here. Who knows? Father, we pray during this invitation that we will realize that you are the author of everything we have. You are the keeper of time. And if we give ourselves to you, everything's going to work out just right. Lord, help us to realize accomplishing your will is the best use of our time from now forward. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to have a hymn of invitation. Please stand. The altar will be open. It doesn't matter if you're a guest here. If you want to make a decision for Jesus Christ, we are here to help you. Please come as we stand and sing.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask Miss Gay to continue playing for just a moment. We're going to sing just a couple more verses, and then we'll close if no one comes. Brothers and sisters, I want you to imagine something, and this is really going to happen. Your turn to stand before Jesus Christ and give account for your life. It's coming. Every one of us has that appointment. We will all stand before the judgment seat. The Bible says it's very plain. Judgment will be, it can be a great day or it can be a bad day. It's all up to us. It's all your decision, just like it's my decision. I can't save you. You can't save me. But Jesus can save each of us and put us in his family. We're going to sing a couple more verses. Please come. If you're not sure of your relationship to Jesus Christ, today is the hour to get that nailed down and get it right. We're going to love you. We're not going to judge you. We're just going to try to help you. Please come. Let's sing another verse. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming today. God bless you. We are so excited about all the things God is doing in all of our lives and in our church family. By the way, I have a special guest, three special guests back there to welcome. Jana and Tommy and Joy Yeomans are visiting today. Hey, wave your hands, guys. They are dear friends of mine and Marcia, and we're so thrilled to do them. He's just accepted a job as a music teacher at Ware Middle? Ware Middle. So he's another music person. We are so proud of all of our teachers and everything. God bless you. It's so great to have you today. Is there anybody else that has a guest you want to recognize this morning? Yes. There you go. Did y'all hear that? She has her nieces here this morning. Miss Lou has them, and we're so happy to have y'all. Bless you. Are there any other announcements before we close? I have one quick one right before we pray. Brother Justin, anything? Yes, ma'am. Miss Sandy? Thank y'all so much for the, that was a wonderful breakfast Friday morning for all the Brantley County School Board folks, too. And we are so appreciative of anybody that came out for that, that our church was able to serve you. Thank you, Miss Sandy. Brother Justin, anything?
One way in the back.
Yep. Prayer rally at the high school at 5 o'clock today. Also, one more thing on your way out. I'm going to ask a couple of the ushers if I'll stand by the doors. Everybody, in 2 weeks, we're having deacon election. Three of our deacons are rotating off according to our bylaws, and we're going to be electing three more. Look over that list. Be praying. If your name somehow was not on the list, and it should be, please let us know as soon as possible. Or if you want your name taken off the list, we'll be happy to do that too. Let us know. We've looked through every man in the church who's been a member at least 1 year and 21 years or older, and all those names should be reflected. We took off some who have moved out of the area. There were some on there who live in Atlanta now. It'd be kind of hard for them to get to church on Sunday morning to be a deacon. And so look over that list. If anybody's missing, let us know, because we're not God. We do make mistakes, right? So we want to make sure we give everybody a chance. And please be praying over that list. We're praying for three more wonderful deacons to add to the ones we already have. Great guys. All right, anything else? Yes, new Sunday school class. Who wants to talk about that? Starting a college and career class, when is that starting? Does anybody know? September, brand new church here. We have a college and career class. That's for those of us who are over a certain age and under a certain age, right? We don't know what those ages are, but we'll let you know when you come there. All right, anything else? All right, I'm going to ask Brother Heimrich if he would close us in prayer. Thank you, brother.